In a vSphere environment. I'm not sure if some of you saw the session on Monday where I gave the high level view on what we're doing with configuring your vSphere environment to a DSC based configuration based environment. First of all, this slide, we can't show it enough. These guys did tremendous work in the last couple of 10 years and more even. Without them, this thing wouldn't be happening, and what I'm going to talk about wouldn't be happening. So thank you to all of those on the list, much appreciated. What are we going to talk about? While the one on Monday was kind of a high level overview, where we looked at the concepts that I'm trying to follow to convert your vSphere configuration to a DSC based one, I'm now going to dive into some code. So for those of you who don't want to see a lot of lines of code, you still have time to leave if you want, or get an extra coffee. I don't know what you prefer, but there will be some code involved this time. I will show you one of the things I'm looking at and developing. It's in a stage that it's usable, but it's open for a lot of expansions, as we will show later on. We'll handle some points more in detail, like we mentioned on Monday. In your vSphere hierarchy, there is a tree structure with all kinds of different nodes in there. You have folders, data centers, clusters, and so on. So determining where your new resource will be created or defined is quite important. That's why the location thing is in there. So we need to make sure that we position ourselves on the right node in that inventory tree the moment we try to create a new resource. There's a small example of reusing code, like we always do, I do at least. I think it was during the last VMworld that we made this famous claim, don't write the code, just steal it. If it's already out there, there's a lot of valuable blocks out there, tons of code, so don't reinvent the wheel. But one thing you should keep in mind, if you copy something from the internet or even your best friend, test it. Don't run it like that in production. We never do that, of course, but just as a warning on the side, make sure that you test what you copy from others. And automation, as it should be the case with everything we do in PowerShell, is our ultimate goal. Who am I? Okay, I'll keep this short since I already had in the previous one. I'm Luc Dekens. I do a bit of talking at VMworld in the last years. We have a book, second edition, just came out. I will plug my book only once, in contrast to some other people, right? And if you want to reach me, there's a Twitter handle that you can use to contact me. And there's a mail link on my blog. If you need more detailed questions than 140 characters in a question. Okay, a quick overview for those who didn't attend that session or already forgot. It has been 2 days of brain melt, at least it has been for me. DSC is a very valuable resource or way of configuring your environment. Now, unfortunately, at the moment, VMware themselves, they don't provide any resources for that. But since we have the option, we had the option in the past and we still have it, to script DSC resources. Now with WMF5, we have the option to do those class-based resources, which is even better, more optimal. I'm trying to start something going where we have resources defined for your complete vSphere environment. So like I showed last Monday, we already have quite a few, but it's still a lot need to be done, especially in the finer details of the configurations. Another thing, an important thing that we want to obtain with converting to DSC is that we want this famous separation of where and what. I just made a small two screenshots at the bottom there. So if you look at that one, the right one is the one where we will actually do something. That is your actual folder name that you're going to create and the location where you want to create that folder name. This is the part that you want to put under source control. This is where the changes will be visible, where you can make the diff with the previous situation. On the left, that's the what you will be doing. That's only a small extract. That is the one that creates a folder, and it uses the data that we specified in the right side text that you see there, which is part of your configuration file. So this is the important concepts and what we are trying to do with DSC for a vSphere environment. Now, I mentioned it earlier, the vSphere inventory tree is quite complex. And this is partially because historically it grew like that. And they added new types of resources that they had to fit somewhere in their inventory tree. What I did here, and most of you, whoever used the vSphere classical client, they will know this view. There are four types at the moment that you can look at. Top left, you have the one where you have the view, what VMware calls the host cluster view. So there you see what they also call their yellow folders. You see the data centers, clusters, and your hypervisors in there. Top right, you see the VM template view. That's the one where you will actually be able to set your VMs in specific folders. And on these folders, you can then apply permissions which will allow you to delegate certain parts of your environment to specific groups of users. What is newer, and that appeared later on, at the bottom left, you have the one for data storage. They have introduced the concept of data store clusters some time ago. That is the hierarchy that you find under there. And then the last one, the fourth one, is where your network configuration is stored in the hierarchy. Again, we have two types of network objects, basically. You have the standard classical switches, the VSS as they call them, and you have the distributed switches, which is VDS. In these screenshots, what you see, the yellow and the blue folders are the ones that you actually define. If you create, for example, in the bottom right, if you create a distributed switch VDS1, it will create a number of port groups by default. Uplinks, for example, will always be there. And then, as you add additional port groups to that specific switch, they will start appearing under this node in the hierarchy tree. So just to make it clear that there are different ways of viewing and at objects in your vSphere environment. So the path is quite important. Now, if we want to make an inventory, so the ultimate goal that we want to achieve is we want to have an inventory of our existing vSphere environment. We're not going to start from scratch once these DSC resources are available. We all, and most of us, have a running vSphere environment, which we want to be able to convert to DSC configuration. So what is important is that we get a complete inventory of that environment to start creating those configuration files. So the obvious one, if you look at the commandlets that are available in PowerCLI, for those of you who don't know what PowerCLI, PowerCLI is an add-on. It used to be a PS snap-in, now it's converting to a module. There are a few PS snap-ins left. What allows you to configure and manage your vSphere environment. So it's on top of your PowerShell tool. Now, the obvious one would be, there is a command with get inventory. When we run this, we see a lot. This comes from a test environment, which I kept obviously very small to make it manageable in one screenshot, in fact. What we see here, we see most of our elements, components of our vSphere environment coming back. But we are missing some. Remember, we had screenshots of distributed switches, of data store clusters. These are not in there, unfortunately. So I did a count, so we can compare with something that I will do later. We have 22 objects returned from your vSphere environment, but it's not complete, obviously. So what do we do? And this is an adagio, a guideline that I give all of the people. If the commandlets don't do what you want to do, you have to go to the API. Now, luckily, PowerCLI from day one foresaw a commandlet, get view in this case, to easily tap into all the API methods and properties. So if you're missing something or you want a very specific configuration which is not provided by your standard commandlet, go to the API. The API is not the most obvious environment to code in. There's an API reference, there's an extract screenshot at the top right here, and setting up or making calls to that those APIs or obtaining those properties in there is not always too obvious. Now, in this case, we are lucky. There is a basic concept, a managed object, which they use internally to retrieve inventories from a vSphere environment. And that's what we are doing here. First of all, everything in vSphere, in the vSphere API, starts from your service instance. This is, so to say, your base object from where everything else is starting. You even find, and that's what we will be using later on, you even find your root folder of your complete vSphere environment. One thing that is quite interesting with the service instance, you can use this against the vCenter. vCenter is the management layer on top of all your hypervisors. Or you can use this exactly same API directly against your hypervisor, the ESXi node in this case. So you use the same scripts to inventorize or a vCenter or an individual hypervisor if you want to configure an individual one. Now, what we did here, there is, like I said, one method, which is called create container view. We use that one to get us a more complete listing of what is in your vSphere environment. Very straightforward. I'm not going to go in too much details. It requires a number of parameters where you start. In this case, we use, like I said, the root folder, which is also available in that service instance. You can specify what kind of types you want to return. And types, that would be things like data center, cluster, virtual machines. And this also explains why with our commandlet get inventory, we don't get everything. Because they only retrieve, because it was written in the early days, they only retrieve the things that we saw. Folders, virtual machines, clusters, hosts, and so on. But they skipped data store clusters and network objects like virtual distributed switches. So what I'm doing in this call, I'm just passing it null. I'm not passing any types, and then by default, it will give you all the types that are available. And the last, the recursive one is an obvious parameter in this case. You just want to run through the complete tree. It's as simple as that. If we run this, we get this kind of inventory. So most of the stuff that we saw in the get inventory command that we will see back, but we now have a complete view. Remember, it was 22 in the previous one with the commandlet. Now we have, what is it, 28 of those. And we also see stuff appearing in there like DVS, DV port groups, data store clusters, and so on. So we have now a complete view of our vSphere environment. But there's too much in there. There are things in there that are normally hidden and that you don't see in the GUI or the web client interfaces that you... Okay. What we want to do, and I explained that in the beginning, location is very important. If we create a new object or want to create it or configure a new object with DSC, we have to be able to exactly tell them in which node we want to create that object. So this is a funny location picture, but it stresses the fact that location can be quite important in some cases. What I'm doing here, we're coding, or trying to code in this case, the path into which a specific object is located. The code again is quite simple. There are a few basic concepts in this script. We are again passing to a vSphere API method. We're using the same create container view. We limit what we want to see. This is an advice that you should always use when you start using this getView commandlet. These internal objects are quite big. There are tons of properties on there. So only retrieve what you actually need. It will make your script a lot faster, especially if you're running in bigger environments. You can imagine that creating something that has 100 properties and returning it takes a lot more time than, in this case, we only need two properties. And the property that is returned by default, the pointer to the object, is always in there. You don't have to explicitly specify it. Now, if we use this code and we run this, now we're getting somewhere. Now we are returning the name of our objects, the type in the second column. And what you see on the right is the parent. So that is the node just above the one that you are listing here in this inventory. It is represented as a pointer, so don't look at that exactly, but it's something that we will use in the next step in our script. what we're doing here, and I'm showing something that I always try to use in my scripts and my functions that I write. First of all, make it modular. If you have a specific functionality that you want to achieve, make it a separate function. That's what I'm doing here with get parent name. Secondly, what is also quite interesting, instead of writing tons of lines of code, make your functions recursive. So traversing an object tree is ideal for a recursive function. So we had the same code as we had before. We are now just creating or going to try to obtain the path to the object that we're looking at. And we do this recursively by calling that get parent name function that you see over there. And then we go a bit deeper in the function itself. We, in the end, when we have the path, we just return that as a property on an object that we create for each inventory object. So this is the ultimate goal. We want to see the object, the type of object, and the parent. The complete path, in fact. And this is what we're having now. What you should be noticing that some of these things in the path, some of the nodes in the path are not appearing. There is, for example, I'm not sure if it's on this one. Yeah, it is. There are the ones in the first red box there. These are what they are called hidden folders. In their inventory system, they made some hidden nodes under which they can attach those four types of objects we mentioned in the beginning of this talk. You have the VM view, the host view, network view, storage view. Those are the hidden folders. Those we don't want, in fact. We are never going to configure them ourselves. So the next step in our script would be to just eliminate those from our script. And that is done quite easily with a where clause, where we can just say, if you encounter an inventory node with that specific name, don't show it to me. I don't want to know it. And on top of that, in the function where we define or create the path to the object, we also skip those. You don't want to have to specify those in the path to the object that you are inventorizing. So this is all very straightforward PowerShell code, PowerCLI code. I guess there's nothing. If there are any questions, don't hesitate to ask. Don't start writing this down. I will publish this when I get back home, and you will find the complete function, because it is a bit bigger in the end. You will find it on my GitHub repository. Okay, we are there. So this is now our inventory, the function that we started with originally. We have all the information we need. We skip the ones that we don't need. So this is quite complete. It's better than the get inventory command, because we also see stuff like the distributed switches. We see the data store clusters. Data store clusters are called internally storage pod. That's why you see it shown this way. But it's the same thing. It's the internal name, which apparently is different from what sales in the end decided it should be named. Now, what are we trying to go to? We want to create, that's our ultimate goal, we want to create these configuration files automatically from an existing environment. So what you see in the red box there, that's the stuff that I want to generate with this script in the end. All the rest in my configuration file is rather static. I could use that in an inline string, code it once, and just create the file. But this part is the part that really depends on what he discovers in your environment. So what I'm doing here, I'm using an inline string, and I just make a placeholder there. That's the one that is marked and highlighted in yellow. That is the one that I will replace with text that I generate based on the inventory we created with the function earlier. So it's a very straightforward thing. All the stuff that is fixed or semi-constant, you can do that in the inline string. And the stuff that is different or will change in your environment, that's the one that we will insert in the text. How we do that, it's very straightforward. Everything is there, it's a string. You just do a replace in place of that marker with the text you generated in the end. Now, there are a few properties on these resources that are quite important. There is, for example, the one where you will tell it your specific node. Imagine a folder, which is a subfolder of another folder. So you have folder one, folder two. We want to define that dependency. So if we create folder two, we have to find a way to say folder one should be there before. So DSC allows you to do that with the depend on. Now we have to create, depending on the path, we have to construct that dependency dynamically from the inventory we are pulling. Again, this is quite, can become quite complex, because a folder can be located under a data center or it can be located under another folder. So there's a bit of logic involved to find the correct dependency that we want to use in our DSC configuration file. In the last lines at the bottom there, I'm actually generating the specific text for that specific event. This is an example from the folder, but we have similar things for data center, clusters, VM hosts. This is just to show you how I do it in the end. There's a bit of logic, for example, for the folders where we decide if it's a blue or yellow folder. Remember, yellow is the VM host cluster view, blue is the VM template view. And in the end, we will arrive with something that is actually usable in our DSC configuration file. There are a few issues that you might encounter when you do this kind of inventory. Suppose, and vSphere allows you to do that, you have this, a folder with the same name but in different locations in your hierarchy. So you have to find a way to actually find the one that you are that you want to look at. Now, I could have written quite some code, but luckily, and now I'm coming back to the point I made in the beginning, don't reinvent the wheel, just steal the code. There is a guy who already wrote a function to do that, which happened to be someone I know. He allows you to give the path to a folder. So he will follow that function, will follow the complete path and give you the correct object. So no more issues if you have likewise named or folders with the same name. You just give the complete path and he will return to you the correct object that you need in this case. So we plug that in our script as well. And then if we run it ultimately, remember it was especially the where part that we were interested in our configuration variable. This is the end result for folders in this case. I just re-included the two screenshots of those two views on the inventory here to show you what we are actually doing there. If you look, for example, at folder four, that's the one at the bottom, the blue folder, you will see that there is a dependency folder 3 should be there before folder 4 is created, which is obvious. It's a subfolder on that one. But in a similar way, we have for folder 2, for example, which is a yellow folder, top view, that's a folder that is hosted, the parent of that folder is a data center. So you then have a dependency, as we show there in the depends all, on that data center home lab that we created earlier or in another line. Now, once you have these dependencies, the LCM will take care of it and he will do the right order, the right thing to regenerate your complete environment. Once you have this stuff, it's quite easy to put this under source control. You can use this to find drift in your environment. Somebody changes, somebody deletes a folder, this will discover. Once you have this defined, in DSC, you will find it and correct it. But you could also use this kind of stuff to migrate your environment. Suppose you have a new vCenter, new version, an update, a new hardware, I don't know what. And you just want to transplant your complete environment. You could create that configuration file and then just use the configuration file to recreate exactly the same structure on that other vCenter. So the use cases for this kind of configuration files are quite interesting, so source control, but also migration and recreation. You can use it in a DR environment where part of your environment would, by disaster, disappear. You can recreate it quite easily that way. Now, this script is producing the files that I showed previously. There are some extensions that I want to create on this script. I'm not there yet, I'm working on it, but they will be coming. There's first of all the integration with Git. There is a very good Git module, or announced at least, that allows you to automatically, once you have that configuration file, you will store it automatically. So automate will be or primary goal, you will automatically store it in your Git environment. And then, were some of you in the previous session with Steve Murawski and Michael Green, I think, on this release pipeline? In fact, this plugs in into what these guys were saying. This is the integration that we ultimately want in our automation, our environment. We want not only to create those configuration files, that's only part of the story. We want to recreate, for example, you create a new distributed switch. Okay, we can generate the configuration file, but I would also like, with this script, since we're handling the object, recreate or create the tester code to test that switch if it's functioning as it should. We have all the information available. We know the name of the thing, we know the configuration settings, we know where it's located. So with this ultimate goal of automate everything, this would be a nice integration that I'm looking at. Same goes for Sake. I want what they announced, these composite resources. It's typical in a vSphere environment, we could use this very well. I think I used the example of a cluster. You have a default cluster, it's just one click. But then again, if you look at the components in a cluster, for example, there's high availability, you have resource scheduling, you have DPM, those require additional parameters. So you could use those as sub-resources under your cluster. And your complete cluster could become one composite DSC resource in that case. So instead of generating all these individual DSC resources, configuration files, the ideal world, we should be able to create a composite resource and just plug in the values that we need for that specific instance that we are trying to move under DSC control. There's one shortcoming in the script at the moment, and I mentioned the blue and the yellow folders, but you noticed as well in the beginning already that there are other types of folders, the hidden ones, remember. There's network and data storage. Those need special taking care of because their paths are a bit different. In fact, they need to make sure that they are created under those hidden folder. If you create a folder where you want to store, for example, all your data store clusters, that folder should be created under the hidden data store folder, not under the VM or host folder. So I need a bit more expansion on that one in the script. Another thing that is quite useful, and this is one of the beauties of PowerShell, you can have access to everything in your environment. In this case, I'm working with this class-based resource, VMW folder. You could look at that resource class, list the properties, and check for completeness. So somebody in your team adds a property to the class, you could use this to check if the configuration files that you are recreating are complete, are containing all the properties that should be there. I know not all of them are required, but still it would be useful to have all of them in there. So this is another part I'm looking at. Use what is available or what is returned by the GetDSC resource to make it more complete what you generate in your configuration file. And then, of course, you noticed my text that I generated was all left aligned. We need a bit more alignment, makes it more readable. But that I consider one of the minor issues that I need to solve in the ultimate script. Are there any questions on this? I know it's a lot of code. It's 10 o'clock in the morning. You have more sessions to come. You have a question?
So, considering our environment, is as a prerequisite to implement these features, is that like just Power CLI agent should be good enough to start, or are there any other prerequisites that needs to be available?
Yeah, this is something in fact that I discussed in the first session, but I can pull up the slide so you can have a look. If you give me a minute, I'll switch to that one. I think I still have it here. Yeah, no problem. That's just a minute. I'll just pull up the slide where I describe this environment that I want to work in, or how I think it should be done. I think I still have. Okay, here it is. What we discussed in short is. You don't see it. Just a minute. That's better. what we discussed in there, this is just a view on the lab I'm using to test this environment, but it gives you a good idea of the setup that I'm propagating here. Bottom right, this blue box, is your vSphere environment. Classical thing, VCSA, vCenter, hypervisors. Top left is your standard Windows domain, domain controller, pulled server. I need a workstation to edit some stuff, so I have two of them because I want to test on 8 and 10 at the same time, but that's just a practical thing. And the key thing in there is this vEngine that you see on the left. So on that vEngine, that is because we can't install LCM agents, VCSA is an appliance. VMware doesn't like you to put stuff in there. ESXi is a closed hypervisor. They don't want you to put stuff in there. So what we're doing is we're installing the LCM agent on that vEngine. And it's on the vEngine that we run the configuration files. On that machine, you need PowerShell and PowerCLI on top of it. That's the one that will actually do the changes in your vSphere environment on the right. So yes, you need PowerCLI on that vEngine. But in the end, you don't need to touch your vSphere environment at all. You just need this helper server. Does that answer your?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions? Yes, Jos.
So folders are inherently designed to contain things.
Yes.
Do you also have resources for maintaining that alignment so that the virtual machines that need to be in a specific folder do not get moved to other locations? Because from an operation standpoint, that's what I see happen more frequently. Mm-hmm. Someone inadvertently, you know, when they're selecting it, they would drag it into another folder and lose it.
Yeah, that's a good. Josh wants to know if the location in your vSphere inventory, if that is or can be controlled by DSC, and yes, it can, of course. If we look at one of the earlier slides, let me pull it up again. Okay, if you remember that slide from earlier on in the presentation, this path at the right, that is in fact the location that you want to look at. And what you are asking, if I understand the question correctly, if somebody would move your VM from folder 2 to folder 3, for example. Now, with the VM in the configuration definition, in the configuration file for the VM, we will have this path. Path will always be there. That's why I'm stressing that obtaining this path is quite important in this complete DSC setup. If DSC, LCM agent, sees that your path is not correct anymore, you will automatically get the set call, and that should correct it. So what we will have in that case, if it fails on the test of the path, you will generate a move to that folder. Same goes not only for folders, but also for data stores, for example, or even clusters where your VM. So ultimately, your DSC LCM could be even in fact vMotioning, SVMotioning machines to comply with the configuration that you defined in your configuration files. So it can go very far in the end. There are some tricks, there are some things that I need to resolve because you have to take into account high availability, for example. You're not going to specify that the VM should run on a specific ESXi node. There are some cases where you perhaps would be inclined to do that. I'm thinking of those VMs, and I at least have them in my environment, some of you probably, where people have applications that still require a dongle or something like that.
Or Oracle,
something like that. You need to fix it on a specific VM, ESXi node. There you would need to override what HA is trying to do with your environment. So it's a bit complex on that level. Yeah.
Would it make more sense to just create DSC resources to manage the DRS rules and make
yes.
sure those DRS rules are in place? So if someone changes the DRS
yeah.
rule,
yeah.
It adds a rule back?
So DRS, the cluster configuration in vSphere has an option DRS, and in DRS you can specify rules where you can create affinities. Those VMs should be running on those ESXi nodes. Yes, I fully agree, but that is more on the level of vSphere management. You should be managing that in any case with rules. Now those rules in itself you can configure with your DSC configuration. That is something that I will add on the cluster resource. We shouldn't rely on only the DSC configuration to define the configuration. I fully agree that it should be in the rules. Sure. Correct. Thanks.
I think that is an extremely valuable use case.
Yes.
Because we still see a lot of people who are running applications like Oracle or even SQL Server, where you're paying like per socket, things like that. Being able to not only say that, you know, I've set up affinity, but I'm also ensuring that that affinity can't be broken.
Yeah.
Provides a lot of confidence if anyone were to try to come and audit you on that and say, well, how do you know that it's not going to move? Like, well, I have affinity. My storage is configured in a certain way so that it doesn't cross over, and I'm using DSC to ensure that if anyone accidentally makes a change to that affinity, it auto-corrects so that we don't get into a situation where we're no longer compliant.
I agree, but on the other hand, I would be more inclined, we heard, that to do this with rules, and DRS will also discover that it's not that we're sitting on the right machine. Perhaps the DRS cycle is not as frequent as the LCM agent cycle, but I consider this more on management of your vSphere environment. LCM is another layer, another level. Getting those rules in the cluster, that I would leave to DSC LCM.
Yeah.
But applying the rule, I would leave that to vSphere in this case. But you're right, you could envisage doing it that way as well. But then you would be recreating the same functionality that is already there in vSphere.
Well, no, I'm simply implying that those affinity rules be set and managed so that they can't be changed with DSC. So vSphere is still doing its thing. It's still responsible for ensuring and guaranteeing that the workload doesn't move.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that you're simply saying that DSC is keeping an eye on the DRS affinity to make sure that those rules don't change, because someone could change one of those rules in DRS in the virtual center server, which could cause a problem that would make you non-compliant. But if DSC is just keeping an eye on that, then that's less likely to happen. So you still let DRS do its thing, not have LCM do it.
Yeah, fully agree with that one. Yeah, good idea. Any more questions? Yeah.
Do you need a vEngine for each vCenter appliance?
No. No, that's the reason why, I'm not going to pull it up again, you remember. With the vEngine, you can use multiple sessions in there. So each session could be connecting to another vSphere server, be it multiple vCenters, be it multiple ESXi nodes, or a mix of those two. No. Because in the resource, I'm going to pull it up in any case, because this is quite important. That was on session one that I can pull it up if I'm not, okay, let me see if I, do we have it here? Nope. I don't have it here. Sorry about this, but I'm trying to find the code that I've. No, I can't find it immediately, but I can show you after the session. What I'm doing is, in fact, in each resource entry in your configuration file, I had two properties, which is vServer, which is the indication to which vCenter or ESXi you are connecting, and vCredential, which is the credential you should use for that connection. So per resource, you can define where it is located. So in the case of multiple ones, you go to the correct one in that case. Does that answer your?
Yeah.
Thank you. Any more questions? Just what I also mentioned in the first session on Monday, these DSC resources are a work in progress. I have a number of them. When I'm back home, I will start publishing them. They are now in a private repository that I'm using to develop them. I will put them on public GitHub, because this thing, this environment is so complex, no one person will be able to do all that stuff. So I'm counting a bit on community contribution there in the coming months. I don't know what. Also on the priorities, because like I said, this stuff is quite complex. I could imagine that I would now, if I put priorities on my to-do lists, that I would first be looking at distributed switches part. Perhaps the majority of the users say I would rather first see a fully working DSC, a cluster resource. So it's in fact up to you guys to tell me, or do the work yourself, or tell me which one should be the next on my list. Yeah, we already reached that one, of course, since we are discussing here questions. No. Any more? Okay, then I thank you for attending this code-heavy session. I hope it didn't bother you. Thanks.